yourself totally over to Him, because we have an awesome God. Before I go into my sermon, there's something I want to say. As the chairman of the Music and Program Committee, I want to say thank you to the young people who planned, executed, and honored us as women, as mothers last Sunday. Amen. I don't think we've ever had young people in charge of Mother's Day. But they executed from beginning to end. I believe they were even, because I am on the committee, they were trying to surprise me so that I didn't know exactly what was going on, only little tidbits. But I want to say to you young people, you did a fantastic job. When you were sleeping Sunday morning, these young people were up 3 o'clock Sunday morning. They had not gone to bed. In fact, when I spoke to one of them, I said, go to sleep. She said, I am wide awake. They were putting on the finishing touches. They were communicating to make sure everything went well. We had an awesome service on Sunday. I don't know about you, but I had an awesome service on Sunday. Applaud our young people. People, applaud our young people. Sometimes we do not show enough gratitude. We do not show enough gratitude to persons who have worked hard behind the scenes to make it what it is. How many of you lady women mothers realize that you walk up the aisle on rose petals? How many of you realize that? I was married, but I can't remember walking up any rose petals. I am married, sorry. And some of you may never get married to walk along in any rose petals. But last Sunday, you walked up the aisle to rose petals that were placed there by our Sunday school children. Give them a hand. Give them a hand. The only rose petals I had was, I think, on my 25th anniversary when a good friend placed some on me. On the bed in my hotel room. We walk up to Canon in D major. You know what that is. But it sounded so serene. Were you listening? Were you listening? And then you had those lovely corsages. I had planned to wear one. When I got here, really, so. I didn't have all its pink. So beautifully made. We want to say thank you to the person who made that, Glenroy's mom.
In Jesus' name.
So beautiful. Do you want to examine them, or you just take them off and throw them on the table and never wear them? All those, don't put them up. Wear them. Wear them. Put it on. Let others see what the young people did for you. Wear it. You look so beautiful in your pink and yellow corsage. And the cupcake. My daughter-in-law said to me, those cupcakes were the bomb. Y'all know what I mean, your people, right? They were the bomb. She said, the cake tasted so good. And she said, you see that icing? And my daughter-in-law loves her stomach. She loves to eat. But I didn't taste any, and I don't think any should have been for me, because I'm not supposed to really. But I am happy for the young lady who made those cupcakes. Lovely cupcakes. Anybody know who made those cupcakes? Rashida. Lovely cupcakes. I didn't know those young people had a bit of a headache last Sunday when they see those droves of mothers. We never had so many mothers in the history of Chalky Mouth. Never. I didn't know it gave them a headache trying to work out those tokens. I didn't mind giving up money. I didn't mind giving up money. I enjoyed from the time I got here and got on my little corsage and walk up to Canon and D Major with the fellas on the ground and I was satisfied and oh my goodness, the worship was awesome. Wasn't it? Wasn't it? It was awesome. And then the word expectant moms. Expect. If you enjoyed last Sunday, applaud our young people. Applaud them. Applaud them. One father told my husband, I hope we get treated the same way when we have Father's Day. Well, yes, man, you're going to be treated. I promise you that. Amen?
Amen?
Thank God. Thank God. I really didn't have to say that, but I felt really special last Sunday. Amen?
Amen?
Let's just bow our heads for a few minutes. Father, I give you praise. And I give you thanks, Lord, for you are a great God.
Yes, He is.
You're omnipresent. You're omnipotent. You are the bright and morning star. You are the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. You are the best. You are the Almighty God. You are the King of Kings. You are the Lord of Lords. You are everything to us. And Lord, today we bring your word. So your word is yourself. Your word is there, Lord, to guide us, to direct us. And I give you praise today for your loving kindness and your tender mercy. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Today I will not be speaking about an attitude of gratitude. When life hands you a lemonade. Today is our resident women's service. And the resident women have for their theme a woman of virtue, a hand of compassion. Today, I want to deal with the first half of the theme. When I looked it up, I think of virtue, but I was pleasantly surprised as to what it means. Proverbs chapter 31, verse 10 states, "Who can find a virtuous woman, for her price is far above rubies." The message I'm going to share with you today was actually given to me by the Holy Spirit as I was doing my chores. Sometimes He speaks to me while I'm laying down. Sometimes He wakes me up early in the morning. And I could actually hear the sermon going around in my head. But this time I was actually doing some cleaning and God was just ministering to me. I pray that as I speak to you today, that you'll be blessed, you'll be ministered to, and you will be empowered. My topic is a woman of virtue. Who is a virtuous woman? And I want to listen to this. Now, this is what the dictionary says. But it doesn't only speak to a woman, it speaks to men as well. A virtuous woman is one who has high moral standards. A godly woman. One who is chaste. And chaste means abstain from sexual immorality. Someone who is decent. Y'all know you refer to people as, she's a decent girl. or she's a decent woman, or she's a decent man, he's a decent boy. You don't know what word decent means. One who standards exhibit what is and is not acceptable for them to do. In this world we're living in today, things are changing rapidly. You only have to sit in front of your television, you realize how things are changing. And as women of virtue, we have to be careful that we don't get caught up in this world's standards of behavior. Some people believe that what is right for you is right for you. What is right for me is my business. The world actually tells us we're too gypsy. We need to mind our business. We have gone so far north, and if you know the glow, if you keep going north, you end up south, right? Mm-hmm. Persons who study geography, if you keep going north, where will you end up? South. And that's what has happened. But let me say to you, we have a responsibility. Don't mind me telling you on your business. You have a responsibility. You have a responsibility to each other within this church. And God is calling you to be leaders. You have a responsibility to your household. And the pastor mentioned this at the beginning of the month of May. And he said, you have a responsibility to the salvation of your household. You have a responsibility to your neighborhood. You do. Do you know what kept us in time past? Persons looked out for each other. We have lost that. I remember my mother saying if she hang clothes on the line, she can go on to town, because my neighbor above, who I call Vi, would make sure she see the rain set up, go and pick up my mother's clothes, open the door and carry them and put them inside. My mom would do the same for her. Now we have become so fragmented as a people. Everybody in their own little corner, and you staying yours. You don't deal with me, and I don't deal with you. Hi, good morning. Yeah. And we think it's only in the heights and the terraces. It's happening in Charlie Mall, where everybody stick to themselves. And we're not looking out for each other anymore. Children are left to fend for themselves when parents go to work. And they roam the streets. And it has a lot to do with us as parents too. Because we don't want anybody to say anything to our children. If your children are doing something wrong, someone in your neighborhood should be able to say to your child, don't do that. Should be able to. A lot of things which are wrong have become right in the world's eyes. It's a serious thing. And we're seeing the effect of it. Social media is picking it up and showing it wrong and passing it wrong. Because we have allowed what is wrong to become right. But God's standards never change. Never change. You can travel from Barbados to Timbuktu, and God's standards remain the same. And he has given us his word. I was listening last night when I went to Daughters of Excellence graduation. And the featured speaker, she lived in Africa for 3 years.
You know what she said? It's no different. God's standards are the same. Excellence in God's sight is excellence.
Yeah. And we have God's manual, the Word of God, to guide us. Do you know what guides us in making right or wrong decisions? Our conscience. Anybody fool you? Our conscience is our guide. God has implanted a conscience in every human being. It is so evident when you see the reaction of very young children. You don't have to say a word to them. They know what they're doing is wrong. And as soon as they either hear you or see you, they'll go running. That's a conscience. They're not very old, they're only about 2 and 3. And you see them react. You see them reacting. It is through our conscience that the moral law is written in our hearts. It's where the moral is. It is not from your lips. It's here in your heart. And it's your guide. Every human being knows what, every human being knows what is right and what is wrong. That moral law was placed in each of you. These very small little ones here. That moral law was placed in them. Today, I really want to speak to the young women of our church, and I want you to listen. When God was leading me down this road, I didn't understand why. Until I saw what happened recently in the social media. And then last night, listening to the featured speaker. We at Chantemont are blessed to have a core of young people. And I don't know you, older ones, so you know that you have a legacy in these young people. That's why you have to pick them up at the beginning. You have a legacy. When you have gone on, these are going to carry on. And we had a legacy, from way back with Sister Millington. We had a core of young people. Young people, you are just carrying on. Where the others have left off. Sister Nita, Odessa Williams. All of them came up in this church. And you're carrying on. As I said, I'm addressing really the young people, but I have something for you men. And I have something for you older women as well. So let me repeat. A virtuous woman is one who has high moral standards. A godly woman, one who abstains from sexual immorality, one who is decent and exhibits acceptable behavior, not one that is set by culture, because culture changes depending on where you are, but one that is set by God, His standards. A virtuous woman. Boaz said of Ruth in Ruth 3:11, "The city of my people know thou art a virtuous woman." The city knew that Ruth was a virtuous woman. How? How would they know that? The city knew that Ruth had high moral standards. People will know you by the fruits that you bear. That's right. By your behavior, how you react to situations. What is so special about a virtuous woman? And I'm going to look at 3 areas. One, the virtuous woman is godly. You heard what I said, young people? The virtuous woman is godly. The virtuous woman has value. The virtuous woman is wise. In other words, she's the Proverbs 31 woman. Godly. It's impossible to be virtuous before God. You can't pretend. But you, all that you do, how you carry yourself, your speech is directed by God. Your speech is directed by God. Nobody, you know, sometimes we hear people say they don't know whether they should do this or they should do that. But if you are godly, the Holy Spirit is going to direct you. That Holy Spirit is going to nudge you. I like when he nudges me. You know what I say to him? Thank you. Thank you. When I have said or done something, he nudges me. And I turn to him and I say, thank you. So, your first step for being a virtuous woman or man is to give your life to Christ. That's your first step. Give your life to Christ. Matthew 6:33 says, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. And there were a host of list of things that came down before this verse. All your needs will be supplied. Everything you would ever need will be provided. I'm not going to say everything will be perfect. Or everything you want, you will get. I am not telling you today that you're going to be rich. What you need to be is happy. Contented with what you have. You know, once you are contented with what you have, you automatically, you are happy. Once you have contentment, you know, you sit down and you watch I never watched it, but I saw it every now and then, Keeping Up with the Joneses. You do not want to keep up with any Joneses. You're Phillips and Carters and what do you call some real names? Yearwoods and Marshalls and Reed, Kelmans, and Jones. God wants you to be you. You don't have to keep up with anybody. You don't know how they come by what they have. You don't know what they went through to get what they have. Do you want to go through what they went through to get what they have? The same lady last night, she had this long CV, bio that was read. You know what she said? That's not how I started. I went through so much. I went through so much before I came to this point. She said, I lay in my bed feeling as though I was going to die. But a friend invited her to church, and that brought about the change. Sometimes you see people where they are, you don't know what they've gone through to get where they are. You don't know. But a lot of persons, women especially, have gone through the grind, as your people would say. They've gone through so much.
perfect world.
No. Don't live in a perfect world. No. So you're going to face things. It's a matter of fact. You don't ask God what you mean?
No.
Well, you could. But you have to face things in life. It's not going to be easy. Nobody promised you a bed of roses. But it is what you do with what you have and where you're at. And let me say this to you, young ones. You are not too small to give your life to Christ. You are not too small. God called them when they were young. He called Samuel. He called David. They were young. He called Josiah to be king, not you. But he called Josiah to be king when he was 8 years old. And when I say, give yourself to Christ, I'm not talking about baptism. That's the second step. The first step is making a commitment to God. That I am going to follow him always. I'm not going to say that you're not going to follow. Because I've never seen a baby get up from the time they come to the mother's womb and walk like I'm walking now. Or let me use somebody younger. Like my good friend there, Christopher, John Christopher. I am sure Alice will tell you many times he fell. You're going to fall. That is where you're going to be tested. You're going to be tested. Things are going to happen. But when you fall, you ever see a baby, and it falls, it stays down there. But the baby's struggling to get up. Sometimes mommy got to go and help it up. And when you fall, try to get up. You know who's coming to help you up? God. He's coming for you when you fall. He is coming for you. Be reassured that God is coming for you. Don't stay down there. Don't stay down there and have self-pity. Oh, God, poor me. And we're displaying that we're down there. You know, we want everybody to know we're down there. So somebody will have pity on us. Get up. Get up. Move on. Young ones, when you give your life to Christ, I want you to make sure that you are active in your church. Get active. Don't warm the benches. I'm sure we can find something else to warm the benches. Nowadays, I have special things like in the cold places that warm the benches. We don't need to warm the benches. We have the sun that can warm the benches. But get yourself involved in church activities. You know what it does? It helps you to keep focus. It helps you keep focus. It is very easy to lose focus when you give your life to Christ. It helps to keep you grounded. If you belong to a cricket team, and every time they have a game, they don't play, what will happen? Eh? You start losing the skills. You forget how to bowl the ball. You forget how to bat. You look clumsy. Are you a Christian, young person? Get yourself involved in church activities. Surround yourself with Christian friends. Watch you know the ones you should be with. You know the ones that you're not supposed to be with. You know that those are the ones that will lead you astray. You see what they're doing. So what you think if you go and be chums with them, what is going to happen? You're going to be led astray.
Choose your friends wisely. My best friend in secondary school was a Christian. Christian lady. Her name was Carleen Ford. Nobody knows her. And we remained friends until she migrated to Canada. Well, close friends. Until she migrated to Canada. We went to each other's harvest. As teenagers, I would go down to her harvest there in St. Thomas, New Testament Church, and she would come up to me. I would go down to her special services. I never missed my morning service, though, letting you know that. Always went to church. But whenever she had a special service, she would invite me, and I would go down. And whenever I had my special services, I would invite her. And although she is, but she's not in Canada anymore, but she's moved to America, we still have that close bond. It's a special bond. We went to ISCF together. I find our children don't even go to ISCF. Our Sunday school children don't go to ISCF. They go to university, pass through. University never went to, what's it called, Dominique?
UCCF.
The InterVarsity, whatever?
UCCF.
UCCF. Don't go. You go. Yeah. Amen. They don't go. And that's why the children is at Kfield can pounce on you and make you believe that there a God does not exist. Because you're not feeding the inner man. I gave my life to Christ when I was just 10 years old, and I can see it vividly in my mind. I remember that Friday night kneeling at the altar and giving my life. I've gone to the altar many times, but that Friday night stayed in my mind when I gave my life to Christ, made that commitment. And the next year, I entered water baptism. Myself and my best friend, not the one that is in Canada, but my best friend at church. Everything wasn't perfect, but I can tell you this, I was involved in everything. Whatever the hell at the church, I was there. My parents took me to everything. Praying, fasting, open air, and I talk about open air, I talk about 4 o'clock in the evening, I talk about 5 o'clock in the morning. And some of your parents will feel, oh, I can't wait my child up her bed to take her to open air. Yes, I mean. And I remember Reverend Carla's Bradford grandmother took her host of grandchildren along with her. Carol Alden. And when they fall asleep, the big one sleeping on her, the next one sleeping on that one, the next one sleeping. I can tell you all of them did not make a commitment to God when I did. But I can tell you, most of them are serving God today. A seed was planted. Mothers, grandmothers, older women, dads, plant the seed. Plant the seed. I'm not saying that sometimes they're not going to go astray. They will go astray. As my best friend then went astray. But you know what? If you keep praying, they will come back. They will come back. So grandmothers and parents, you have your role to play. Plant the seed in them. And when they go astray, they will come back. God is depending on you. A virtuous woman is a godly woman. A virtuous person is a godly person. My second point is the virtuous woman has value. And we see that in the latter part of the verse, Proverbs 31:10. Who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies. Her price is far above rubies. Far above rubies. What does that say? Angela, give me one word for far above rubies. What is it saying about the virtuous woman? One word, what?
Priceless.
Priceless. You are priceless. Turn the next person beside you and tell them, I am priceless. You believe that? You really, really, really believe that? Are you sure somebody give you a big diamond ring on your hand? Oh, Lord, you feel real good. You worth more than that. You worth more than that. You feel good with the diamonds, especially girls when they get engaged and they got diamonds. You feel real good, right? But you know you worth more than what is on your finger. Think about yourself. Think about yourself. You worth more than that. It is said that the ruby is a red sapphire, next in value to the diamond. You worth more than that. You are a gem in God's sight, young people. He is who matters. No matter what anybody may tell you about you or say, God matters to you. The one that is sitting beside you know. The one that has his hands around you. You feel him? His hands are around you. You are special to him. Do not let anyone put a price tag on you. Don't let anybody put a price tag on you. You are more than a minibus ride, young people. So many young people are selling themselves for a minibus ride. You are more than a cell phone. I don't care if it's a 6, 7, 8, 9, or 10 Samsung. You worth more than that?
That's right.
Oh, yes. They're offering you the best. And you are selling yourself. Don't do it. You are more than a top up. Or hairdo. Or pedicure. I know you like the long, fancy fingernails. All the diamonds on them and so on. Don't be bought. Don't cheapen your value. And I'm speaking both boys and girls. Don't cheapen your value. You are special in God's eyes. Say it after me. I am special.
I am special.
I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Yes. God fearfully and wonderfully made you. That complex human body that you have. God gave the human body a lot of thought. Anybody who studied biology will know how complex the human body is. They can't make one. They would like to clone one. The scientists would like to make a body, but they can't. They give you a robot. They will give you a robot. They even try to clone them. Even try it with the sheep. I can't remember what. The sheep or the goat. They try to clone the sheep. They soon die. There's only one you. You are special. God made you, you down to the tiniest detail. Down to those capillaries, those little cells in your body. You're walking, going along, but you don't know what a gem you are. When he finished, made you, he said, you are very good. Everything he made, very good. You are God's masterpiece. Look in the mirror, Kareem. You are God's masterpiece. When you look in there, see those sweet high cheekbones? You are God's masterpiece. You are his artwork. If you got full lips, flaunt them. God gave you them. Some people go and inject things in them to get full lips. And you got full lips, you. Because you want the white people. And the white people are injecting to get your licks. Love yourselves.
Amen.
Love yourself. Stop complaining about your hair. White people wish they could do all the fancy things that you black people do with your hair. Walk on the beach and then how you get could I hair straight, you know what? You get the hair do like Dominique's one. Call it they will pay anything. And your hair will be tanning. They want a little of your complexion, you know. But you want to be white. They want a little of your, what you take their time for? To get that brown skin.
That's true.
They can't be black. They've got to paint black. They will got to paint back black. But they tan so they can get some of the brown skin. Why don't you value yourself? You are not defined by what you wear. You are not defined by your clothes. And I'm not talking about what the youth talk about on Friday night. So many people think, if I cannot wear the brand, I am not with it.